Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you for attending today's webinar by WSO2 and hosted by Intelligent Systems Inc. The title is Advancing Digital Economies with API Using WSO2 API Manager. We'll be discussing the role of API management in an API-led digital economy. So, I'll do a brief introduction of our company and why we're talking about APIs. And then the presentation will be followed by a few minutes introduction of WSO2 and the role of API management by WSO2. Then we'll have a Q&A portion. So, my name is Winston Palma. I'm the Director of Solutions and Consulting for Intelligent Systems. We would like to discuss APIs today because we believe that APIs are the key components of today's digital transformation, digital experiences in today's digital economy. And because of the pandemic, everything is going, digitalization is accelerating. So it's easy to build APIs from our favorite languages like .NET, Java, Python. But in reality, to be production ready, to handle millions of transactions, we need a robust API management. So this is today's topic, and WSO2 will show you how we can put production ready APIs using the WSO2 platform. So a brief introduction of Intelligent Systems. It's an IT systems integration company. It has been around for 20 years. It offers solutions, services, and staff augmentation. So we carry partner products for banking, such as API management, API banking, digital payments, digital wallets, payments, and even core banking. Then we also build custom software applications, and we do RPA and BPM. We also have SQA services, IT staff augmentation, and managed services. So we were founded actually to build free email in the early days of the internet, but then the Y2K came. Because of our background in project delivery and enterprise applications, we focused on Y2K. So today, most of our clients are in banking, and we have 150 personnel on board. So why Intelligent Systems? Experience and expertise, proven 20-year background, especially in banking. So integration has become our specialty. We have connected mainframes to web browser systems, and going to APIs is a natural outcome of this because of APIs are a solid way to do integration. So, because of our passion to deliver solutions, we like to design solutions that actually reuse your existing systems. We just interconnect them together through APIs and integration. And WSO2 is a good platform to do that. And we also build custom applications that are not handled by your packages, so you can realize your digital transformation. So we're solutions driven. We like to focus on the solutions. We do collaborate with you on projects, and we realize projects are not just about technology and skills. It's a life cycle. So we like to deliver solutions and achieve your satisfaction. In short, solutions that work for you. So the WSO2 partnership, we are an active partner of WSO2 in the Philippines. And why we chose WSO2? 3 years ago, we were tasked to build a middleware for mobile banking to a AS/400 core banking system. It has to have 200 TPS and 150,000 transactions a day, be microservices ready. And we had to deliver 80 secure endpoints within 3 months for UAT. And Operations team wanted API monitoring and logging and token management. So since we are familiar with Spring Boot, we estimated the effort to need 15 developers and at least 6 months. So we looked for viable alternatives and we found WSO2. Basically, it's open source, it's proven, it's used by eBay. So we were able to build APIs, even though it's POC. Actually, it's already production ready because it comes with instrumentation and monitoring. So we were able to deliver the 80 endpoints in 3 months' time for UAT. So WSO2 is a Forrester Gartner recognized company. And so far, working with WSO2 has been very positive. They're very helpful. So it's a pleasure to work with them. So I think I'll hand over the floor to WSO2 to further introduce their company. So thank you.
Right, thank you, Winston. Just give me a second, I'll share my screen. Hi, everyone. So my name is Shiva. I'm from the account management team at WSO2. So thank you very much for the warm introduction, Winston. So just to start things off, I'll start off with a few fun facts about WSO2. So we are the world's number one open source integration vendor. We are the sixth largest Apache committer and the seventh largest open source vendor in the world. So this is a quick overview of the WSO2 and what we do. So we were founded back in 2005 by Dr. Sanjeeva Veerawarna and Dr. Paul Freemantle. So we are a strong team of 750 plus employees world over, of which 50% of our workforce is in the engineering and the research and development end. So we are 100% open source company, so that which means that all our products are free for anyone to download and start using. We also have 500 plus customers around the world, of which 150 new customers were onboarded back in 2020 last year. So we are headquartered out of Mountain View, California. We also have offices in Colombo, New York, London, São Paulo, Sydney, and Berlin. So myself and Nadisha, the keynote speaker today, are based out of our Colombo office in Sri Lanka. So given last year was a pandemic year, it was rather a good year for WSO2, which is a strange thing to say, but we had a 23% year-on-year growth last year as more companies started realizing the importance of digitization. Right, so what we offer at WSO2. So our main product portfolios consist of three key products, which is the WSO2 API Manager, the WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, and the WSO2 Identity Server. So we also have built a couple of industry accelerators based on these three products, which is the WSO2 Open Banking and the WSO2 Open Healthcare. So the Open Banking is predominantly on the GDPR and the PSD2 and the Australian regulations. Whereas the Open Healthcare is on the HL7/5 standards. We also have a WSO2 strategy consulting where we work with a lot of multinational companies to help them realize their digital roadmap. Right, so what is the WSO2 advantage, you may ask? So, like I said earlier, all our products are free for anyone to download and use. Hence, it can be easily incorporated into any organization, hence allows most organizations to unlock new opportunities. Given our product is open source, our source code is also readily available for everyone to access. Hence, anyone can build accelerators in line with their core value propositions. Also, given that we are an open source company, the only cost component attached to our products is the subscriptions and licensing. Which also makes us a very cost-effective solution in the market out there. So our products are also technologically advanced, which means that our products can be deployed on-prem, on a hybrid model or on a cloud platform or even on a microservices and containers like Kubernetes. Yes, so these are some of the industry recognitions we have gained over the last couple of years. So as you, Winston mentioned, Forrester Wave has ranked us as a leader in API management solutions and a strong performer in customer identity and access management for the years 2020. At the same time, Gartner placed us as number one open source integration suite vendor for the year 2018. Also, Kubernetes Core placed us as an overall leader in the CIAM space for the year 2020 as well. Yes, so like I said, our products are very industry agnostic, so that, which means that we work with a lot of industries across many different geographies. So majority of our revenue is comes from the BFSI industry. So we work with a lot of financial sectors. So some of the leading financial agents we work with are Wells Fargo and the Fidelity Bank in the States. We also work with BDO in the Philippines. We also have we also work with OCBC and Standard Chartered in the Southeast Asian region as well. Right. So we work with about 150 plus partners in 70 plus countries worldwide. And one such partner is Telligent Systems in the Philippines, who we work really closely with, helping our customers harness the WSO2 technology with our partners. Right, so what is the WSO2 engagement model? So as you know, our product is open source. The WSO2 revenue model is predominantly based on licensing and subscription services. So where we have, through our licensing and subscription, we give updates, security patches, and bug fixes for all our paying customers. We also have a 24/7, 365 days expert incident level support. And also we have query support on our production environments for all our paying customers. Yes, so that's a quick snapshot and an introduction on the WSO2. I will now hand it over to our keynote speaker, Nadisha Gamage, to take this forward. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Shiva. Let me quickly share my screen. Okay. Hi, everyone. Good morning and good afternoon. My name is Nadisha Gamage. I'm a solutions architect at WSO2. And today's topic would be a role of API management in an API-led digital economy. So I will move on to my slides. So if you look at from an industry standpoint, APIs, the facts about APIs now account to about 25% of internet's traffic. McKinsey in 2017 predicted identified that there's due to API, there's $1 trillion up for grabs through redistribution of revenue. And Benson and Bourne in 2018 suggested that some organizations, 25% of some organizations' revenue purely comes through APIs. So APIs play a huge role in digital transformations and allowing organizations to get on board the digital economy. So let me move on to my next slide. So I'll just give you a brief introduction about how the APIs would play a part in the digital economy. So in order to understand the role of APIs in the digital economy, we need to understand what constitutes a digital economy. So from a explanation standpoint, digital economy is the economic activity that results from billions of everyday online connections among people, businesses, devices, and data, and even processes. The backbone of the digital economy is connectivity. So it's about connecting different components, different stakeholders together to build value to your end customer. Interconnectivity allows organizations, assets, processes, and data to be easily consumed by other stakeholders who are part of the value chain. So that's the whole idea of the digital economy. If I put this the concept of digital economy on a Venn diagram, so the one part of it is you need to have connectivity between people, processes, systems, and data. And the other part is whoever who's consuming those services should be able to easily consume that data, and it should be easily adoptable. So where these two circles meet is through an API. So API allows an organization to provide swift connectivity of its internal assets, people, processes, and data, while it also gives you the ability to easily consume that data from a consumer standpoint, where they can come and easily consume that data and make use of that information that is shared by an organization. So that's the main objective of an API. So API is, in essence, is really an encapsulation of your intellectual property. So organization would have different types of intellectual property, and APIs is a way of encapsulating that intellectual property and exposing it for different consumers. Again, this particular diagram also talks or shed light on how this concept works. So organizations would have its own assets, services, and so on. They will be exposed as APIs for different types of consumers. They can be a mobile app, B2B consumer, say a partner or a third-party vendor. It can be third-party applications, a web portal, and so on. And all these different types of consumers would come and consume APIs that are exposed from an organization. So why this has to be APIs? There are many other ways that you can expose different processes and systems. Why does it have to be APIs? APIs really provide a channel to expose information to a wide variety of customers in an efficient manner or an effective manner. And the most important point is that it standardizes the way communication happens between applications, data, and services. So API makes it uniform, and at the same time, it makes it easy to consume. It makes the data and the systems easy to be consumed by your consumers. Having APIs would allow you to build tailored custom experiences on top of the business assets to improve the overall experience of your customer. So when you have an API available, you can allow your own development team or even an external development team to come in and build different types of custom experiences on top of those APIs, and then provide a superior product to your customers. This, in fact, is actually seen by most of the banks or in the banking industry, especially in the Europe, where there's aggressive open standard initiatives like PSD2 happening that allows organizations to expose or banks to expose their APIs out, and different third-party application developers to come in and build applications that are purely focused on building a superior customer experience for the customer using the bank's APIs that are exposed from the bank's end. So the entire story is enabled via APIs. So what actually drives the need for APIs? Of course, there's value to it, but what actually drives that need? One of the most common reasons that drives the need for APIs is the explosion in the number of connected devices. So you would have different types of devices trying to connect, and that brings the requirement to have APIs exposed to consume different types of services available. And then there is better integration in the value chain. So there is swift integration with your partners, suppliers, with your third-party logistics providers, and all that is integrated as part of a single value chain. And to come to my third point, the rise of customers who are empowered by technology, and customers also demand organizations to provide better services. So that actually is the reason that drives a lot of need for APIs, because customers demand organizations to provide better experiences, better products, better services. So organizations will have to leverage on the APIs to build these experiences and services for their customers. And in that journey, what organizations have realized is that the audience is much bigger than what they think it is. Organizations traditionally would serve a segment of a customers or a segment of a market. But once they have their APIs exposed, they realize that they can reach to a wider audience, different types of segments that previously could not be reached by the traditional channels that are available. So APIs essentially enables an organization to reach to these different channels. So again, it's no longer about company owning a particular asset. It's about how that asset can be made available to consumers when, where, and how they want it. So customers have moved away from having a competitive advantage because of the assets they own, but now they have to augment those assets or put them in a proper way that the assets can be consumed easily by their consumers, how and when they prefer to consume them. So that's what actually changes the industry to become more API driven. Even traditional organizations are now embarking on this API journey or have already embarked on this API journey and trying to build innovative services to serve their customers. So if you look at APIs as a business channel, it actually provides the opportunity for a business to scale without physically expanding. A good example is you might have a electronic shop that has a store inside a mall. So your reach is limited to people who actually visit that mall. But once you have APIs available, you have the option of expanding the business beyond your physical presence to different types of customers and consumers who can come in and consume. For example, they can see what are the products that are available, pricing and all that via an API. So you have the option of integrating your product or in the case of electronic reseller, you have the option of connecting your listings or your catalog to different types of e-commerce services that are available via APIs that are exposed from your site. So you have that option as a business. And you have, at the same time, you have the option of reaching customer segments who are unreachable through the existing channels. Similar example to what I mentioned earlier, where APIs allow you to reach to different types of customers who was previously not reachable with your existing channels. And it actually enables indirect sales via third-party apps, especially seen in the hotel industry, where lot of revenue is now driven to hotels, or in the pre-COVID era is driven to hotels through third-party trip organization sites like TripAdvisor, who does this hotel aggregation kind of a model where they aggregate room availability of multiple hotels and provide to customers to choose from. So that kind of indirect sales can be driven through APIs, and it has enabled a lot of third-party companies to come in and play this aggregator role and build additional value to the end customer. So we talked a lot about how APIs can be beneficial to your organization, but does it solve everything, or does it solve all the problems that you have in the organization when it comes to reaching different new customers? The quick answer is no. APIs itself can get you to a certain place, but if you want to really expand, you need to look at how you can manage those APIs properly and maximize the usage of those APIs. Some of the business concerns of exposing APIs out is how can it be exposed in a standard way that can be easily consumed by different stakeholders. Another key question or another key concern is how can the APIs be secured? You are talking about exposing internal assets of the organization, internal systems of the organization. So you need to have that security built in to ensure that your APIs are secured. You also have to have a way of tracking the usage of the API to see how the APIs are used. And if they are used heavily, you can look at monetizing those APIs and earn some revenue out of it. That's a business concern and a possible avenue that business would like to explore. Another concern is once you have APIs, how can the internal stakeholders easily create and publish APIs to a common platform? What makes that process easier for your internal developers so that they can keep on adding new APIs and improving the existing APIs that you already have? And finally, how can the adoption process be made easier so that you can have more and more consumers coming in, self or go through the documentation or whatever the guides that are available and be able to integrate in the most effective way, the easiest way to consume these APIs that are exposed. Some of the technical concerns, on the other hand, is the most important one is how can I protect internal assets to ensure that only authorized people have access to those APIs. Another concern is how can we push changes to an API without impacting the existing consumers. So if your APIs are gaining traction, you would have a lot of consumers consuming them. So whenever you push a change, how will it not impact your existing consumers? So you need to think about those from a technical aspect. And you also want to make sure that your APIs are reliable, and how can you make those reliable, make it high available and so on. And as your usage increase or as the consumers flock to use your APIs, how can you scale this to make it a scalable business and at the same time make it reliable to ensure that this is a sustainable business that you can drive and build revenue or bring revenue in through this API channel. So all these are technical concerns that you will worry about when you have APIs exposed from your organization. So what's the solution to this? The solution to the problems that I mentioned is to have an API management solution or API management product. The API management product primarily gives you the ability to easily manage your APIs. It provides a platform through which your consumers can easily adopt and use the API. API management tool allows you to build the system to be resilient, reliable, and highly available. It gives you the ability to monitor and monetize the APIs that you expose. And finally, the most importantly, it allows you to secure APIs from a single point. So those are the advantages or features that API management tool will bring into the picture. So API management, to elaborate on this further, it actually allows you to expose all your APIs from a central gateway or a combination of gateways. So you have a single point through which all your APIs are exposed. Allows you to enforce access control via this single point of entry, which is the gateway. It allows you to easily design, publish, and manage your APIs from an internal API developer point of view. And from an external API consumer standpoint, it allows you to easily discover, try out, and use APIs within the platform. It provides reliability, high availability, and backward compatibility for your APIs. And most importantly, it gives you an understanding of the usage trends and gives you the ability to monetize your APIs and make it a revenue stream for your organization. So WS2 API Manager is a purpose-built API management product that can actually cater this type of a requirement. The product has multiple components built in, which we've broken down into three planes. I'll start with the management plane. So management plane has API publisher and a developer portal. Publisher is the interface that is exposed to your internal developers to create and manage your APIs. Developer portal is the interface that is exposed to your external API consumers, or people who will actually use your APIs to come in and discover APIs, try them out, generate their keys and manage their overall API consumer experience through the developer portal. From a runtime or a data plane standpoint, there are two components involved. There's an API gateway, which is a fully fledged API gateway component, and then which is designed to run on VMs. And on the other hand, we have a micro gateway, which is a stripped down version of the API gateway, which is designed to run on containers. And then if I talk about the control plane, there are multiple components involved. Most importantly, the key management component, which is responsible for auth key management. There's a traffic manager component, which is responsible for throttling and rate limiting. And there's an anomaly detection or the analytics component, which is responsible for analytics, alerting, and other QoS or quality of service gauges that we've enforced from the API manager to be viewed from this particular component. All these components are built as part of a single product. So once you deploy the API manager, you have the ability to use all these components within. If you are going for a large scale deployment, you have the option of deploying these components separately so that they work as a distributed deployment. So right now you have the option of doing both at the same time. From analyst standpoint, the API management solution is recognized as a leader by Forrester in their latest Forrester report. We are considered as a leader along with other leading API manager product vendors like IBM and Google. So that's the latest report on the API manager. So I'll talk about some of the capabilities that are required from API manager standpoint to build proper APIs that can actually fit or work in the digital economy space. So let's start with the API security standpoint. The main concerns is how to ensure APIs are not accessed in an ad hoc manner, how to ensure APIs are accessed only by authorized users, and how to ensure that your APIs are not exploited or overused. How the product supports this particular requirement is all API requests will come through a single API gateway or set of API gateways. So there's no ad hoc use of APIs. The API gateway becomes a policy enforcement point. So whatever the policies you define can be enforced from this API gateway. And so the advantage of this is backends doesn't really have to worry about API security. They can, they don't have to protect individual APIs against this security or enforce security at this APIs itself. You can delegate it to the gateway. Gateway will actually do the security and authorization and authentication. And once you are authenticated and authorized, it will allow requests to come into your backend services. So that's the advantage of having an API gateway working as a policy enforcement point. So to put this on a picture, you would have different types of consumers consuming your APIs. You have your API gateway, which is the policy enforcement point. And all the APIs will go through the API gateway and it will be routed to your backend services. So this API gateway layer can have one gateway or it can have multiple types of different gateways, but they work as a single API gateway layer that actually facade or acts as a facade for your backend services. Second concern in terms of API security is how can you authenticate and authorize the APIs? So from a WS2 API manager standpoint, authentication and authorization is supported by different methods. Or one of the most common ways organizations use our product is for in terms of the authentication and authorization is using OAuth 2. Product supports all commonly available grant types, as well as we have written some additional grant types as well. We support JWT-based authentication, again, an extension of OAuth 2. We support API keys, mutual authentication, and basic authentication in addition to the OAuth 2 support that is available with the product. At the same time, we do have an inbuilt key management server, as I mentioned earlier, but the product also provides you the option of integrating with a third-party identity provider for key management. So you have the option of delegating authentication to one of your existing key management servers if required, rather than using the inbuilt key management capability. The product supports authorization of APIs and resources based on user roles. So you have the option of integrating the product to your LDAP or Active Directory and authorize APIs based on the roles that are available in this Active Directory or LDAP. And at the same time, if you want to do attribute-based access control, the product has the extensibility to extend and integrate with the SACML entitlement server that allows you to do attribute-based authorization for your APIs. So this particular diagram depicts how the interaction between the API gateway and the key manager works. So API gateway in this case is the policy enforcement point, and it integrates with the key management server, which is the policy decision point for OAuth 2. And whenever a request comes in, the flow is that the gateway will, in essence, consult the key manager, or it has a local key cache that it will actually consult and see whether this request is authenticated. If not, API gateway will block the request. If it is actually authenticated and authorized, it will allow the request to go through to the backend service. The third aspect for API security is throttling and rate limiting. The product supports usage control based on subscriptions. So your API usage can be linked to a subscription, and that subscription can have throttling tiers and rate limiting and so on. You could have multiple levels of subscription within a usage plan. Usage control based on the number of requests or bandwidth. So there's two metrics that we use. Most common is the number of requests that comes through. The second option is to throttle based on the usage of bandwidth, how much bandwidth that this particular API uses. Throttling and burst control. So we do have the option of doing burst control as well, so that it can be built as part of the solution to ensure fair usage of your APIs. And it also has the ability to protect your backend against overuse. So if a backend has a hard limit in terms of how much request it can take, we can define that particular hard link or the hard limit within the API manager itself, so that API manager you make sure that accumulated amount of requests that comes in at any given time does not exceed this backend hard limit that you have within the backend. Okay, so that's about security. So let's move on to other aspects that are provided through API management. Ease of management is one of the key aspects to have a proper API practice or APIs in place. The requirement is to have a portal to create, publish, and manage APIs. And WS2 actually has that capability. It has the ability for you, or it gives you the ability to create APIs from open API specification or Swagger. So you have the option of uploading a Swagger doc and creating an API. The product also supports lifecycle management. The product supports versioning of APIs and support backward compatibility. Admin APIs are available if you want to programmatically publish and manage APIs. And most importantly, it gives you the ability to go through an API first development methodology to create APIs before the backend becomes available by having mock implementations available, so that someone can actually make sure that the API is working your external developers can actually work in parallel as your backend is being developed by accessing the APIs that actually links to a mock backend rather than the actual backend. So that capability is already available in the product. So this is a screenshot of the publisher portal of the API manager. If we do have time, I'll actually go through quickly to take you through the process of creating and publishing an API so that you get an understanding of how this publisher works. Then the other aspect of this is easy adoption. So you need to make sure that your APIs can easily be adopted by your consumers. So the idea is to have a portal that lists all the APIs out. The documentation should be available. There should be SDKs that allows third-party developers to come and download the SDK and quickly integrate with the API. They have the portal has the ability for you to try out the APIs before adoption. So we do provide this tryout feature within the portal itself, so you can try an API out before actually integrating with your application. And the solution provides API productization, where you may have three different APIs providing three types of services. You can actually build an API product that uses resources from these three separate APIs and then collect them in a single product as an API, so that whoever who's coming in to consume these services can simply subscribe to a single API and use all the services that are available from multiple different APIs that you have within the organization. So these are some of the developer portals that are built by our customers using WS2 API Manager. These are some of the public portals that are available. So last point is availability and reliability. The product should be made available and reliable. It should be flexible when it comes to deployment. So you could deploy on VMs or on containers. You have the option of deploying on multiple deployment zones, multiple geographical zones, and at the same time, eliminate any single points of failure. So the product gives you the flexibility to deploy, as I mentioned earlier, having all the components together and have two of them as seen here on the left-hand side of your screen. And on the right-hand side of your screen depicts a distributor deployment where individual components are taken out and deployed separately. So you have the option of deploying them even in different network segments within the organization to meet whatever your network and compliance requirements that you have within the organization. Yeah. So I'll quickly touch upon monitoring and monetization as well. The product allows or product collects statistics on the API usage from a consumer and a publisher standpoint. It gives you the ability to understand the usage pattern and monitor service availability, trigger alerts, and so on. And most importantly, gives you the ability to monetize the API usage if required by integrating with third-party payment providers as well. So these are some of the this particular image shows some of the dashboards that are available to get different types of API statistics that are available or that are made available through the platform. Okay, so what I'll do now is I'll quickly move on and show you a quick demo of the product, walk you through the process of creating an API and publishing it to the portal, and experience in terms of coming in and subscribing to this API. So what I'll do now is I'll log in to our publisher portal. So in the publisher portal, you'll see all the APIs that are created right now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new API, and you have multiple options or ways in which you can create an API. If you already have a open API definition or a Swagger document, you can simply upload it and create the API. If you have a GraphQL SDL, you can do so as well. So what I'm going to do in this case is design a new API through the wizard that is provided. So I'm going to call this customer information API. So I'm required to give a context as well and a version. So I provided a name, context, and a version. I am required to provide an endpoint. I do have an API that's already been created, so I'll use that endpoint. And you are required to provide what throttling tiers you should allow for this API. All these throttling tiers are customizable. So I have created this limited access tier for this particular demo. So I'm going to use this as the throttling tier and create the API. So API creation is simple as that. So your API is now created. So you can further customize it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to this resource tab. By default, all the resources as well as HTTP verbs are enabled. So I'm going to delete that. I'm going to provide a custom resource or custom URI pattern with the HTTP get verb. So I'm going to make this slash customer info and add this. And it's a HTTP get verb that is supported. This particular request accepts a query parameter, which is the customer ID. So query parameter is the customer ID and it's of type string. And I will add this as well. So once I'm happy with that, I can save this. In addition to what I just did from the resource standpoint, you can actually customize this further. Like for example, if you want to change the security options, you can say by default OAuth2 is supported. You can even add other types of security methods available. Transport level, you can decide whether it's going to be HTTP or HTTPS. You can even enable mutual SSL from this wizard itself. Apart from that, if you are okay with all the configuration, you can go and try this API out before it being published or before it gets published to the developer portal. You can quickly go to this particular get custom info and try this API out. So let me try this out with a custom ID and my API work as expected. So I get a XML response back with the customer information for this API. So I'm happy with all the information that I've provided. So I'm going to go to lifecycle section. Currently the API is in prototype state. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to publish this to publish state. So now it has been published and it is available in the developer portal. Okay. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to log out from the publisher. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the developer portal. So developer portal is another interface that is available. So by default logs me in. Okay, so I'm logged out again. So the developer portal is the view that your API subscribers or API consumers would actually see. Developer portal is customizable based on your themes or based on your own organization's requirement. So this lists out all the APIs that are available, and it also has this newly created customer information API that we can use. So it's two pages on API. So what I'm interested is in this customer information API. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna sign in. At the point of sign in, you can either create your own account. We do provide the self sign up feature. And if you do have an account already, you can use the credentials and login. Just to add on the self sign up feature, this is enabled by default, but you have the option of disabling this entirely, or you have the option of integrating this with a workflow. So whenever you do a self sign up, it doesn't onboard the user immediately. That particular sign up needs to be approved by an administrator, and only if it is approved, you will be enrolled to the system or to the platform. So I have a account created already. So I'm going to log in using that account. So my account is, username is subscriber1. So I'm logged in now. So I can see this customer information API being available. So what I'm going to do is I can actually walk through what information is available. So there's no information and comments available. If the publisher has uploaded any documentation, it will appear here. So the users can have this one-stop shop to see all the information relating to API. It sees what are the resources available, and you can actually test this out as well. I'll come to that later on. So I'm happy with what are the what information is available. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to subscribe to this API. So I have an application called the kiosk application created. For this particular API, only one tier is available, which is the limited access throttling tier. And I'm going to subscribe to this API under the kiosk application. So now I have the option of trying this API out. So I can actually generate a test key and try this API out. And I get a response back. So if I actually want to use my own keys, I can go to application, select my kiosk application, and there's production key section that actually lists my production key. So you have a you have your consumer key and the consumer secret. And then what you can do is you can generate an access token. I don't want to define any scopes. And what it does is it actually generates a JWT containing my access token. So let me copy this, go back to my API, use this tryout button and use my JWT to access this API. Provide the custom ID again. And I get a response back. So if I continuously try to use this API, I will get a throttled out message saying that my quota has been exceeded. So my quota in this case is 5 requests a minute. So on the 6th request, I get this message saying that my quota has been exceeded, and it gives me a time in which the quota will be reinstated on my account. So this is what is available. So again, it's reinstated, and if I continue to use, again, I get throttled out. Okay, so that's on the developer portal standpoint. So I'll quickly touch upon the analytics point of view as well. So I have analytics component running. So from analytics standpoint, if I log in as admin, I see a lot of different types of stats. So let me go to monitoring. So this gives you kind of a dashboard on how many requests has come through. So as this 12 requests come through, 8 has been throttled in the last 24 hours. And then the highest latency is 38 milliseconds from my API. So if I go to latency, I'll actually see the latency breakdown of different types of APIs. I can actually select this custom information API and see the latency breakdown. So what the majority of the latency comes from the backend and the security layer. So you can actually see a good breakdown in terms of how this latency works. There are other type of other different types of data available as well. So if I go back to, there's multiple dashboards available. So there's monitoring for different types of use. So if I go application analytics, it gives me the application level view, how many applications available and so on. If I go to API analytics, it gives me an API level picture. So how many APIs available, which APIs are being used, the performance of different APIs and so on is provided through this analytics component. Okay, so that kind of concludes what I wanted to demonstrate and discuss today. I would like to use the rest of the time to answer your questions, if you have any questions from your side. There are a few questions. One question is, what version of WS2 product that is used for the demo? So the version that is used for the demo is 3.2 version of API Manager, which is the latest version of the product. So that's the answer to the question. We have another question which asks about what level of customizations are possible in the developer portal. So yeah, developer portal is based on React.js user interfaces. So there's so from a customization standpoint, we have given a lot of flexibility in terms of customization. So most of our customers who use the developer portal has customized it extensively to match their brand, their theme, and so on. And that, of course, gives you the since it's React.js, most of the UI UX engineers who are available in customer teams can actually work on those UIs and customize it. That's there. And then at the same time, we also have these REST APIs, store APIs that are available, exposed from the platform as well. So there are instances where customers have built their own developer portal using those APIs. And so in that case, they don't depend on our developer portal, but completely depend on the exposed APIs, developer portal APIs, and then build their own portal using those APIs. We have another question in terms of, so what kind of flexibility is available in terms of API versioning? Yeah, so the product gives you a lot of flexibility again in terms of versioning. So as a as an API publisher, you can have, say you publish version 1.0, and then later on, so that particular version can be the default version as well. So if you don't define a version as part of your URL, it will, the request is routed to the default version. So say whenever the user or whenever the organization moves to a different version of the API, you can set the new version as the default version. So anyone who's actually not using the version number in the URL parameter will be redirected to the version 2.0 that is available. Existing customers can continue to use the version 1.0. The product gives you the capability of deprecating old version. So whenever the version 2.0 is available, you can deprecate the version 1.0. So any new subscribers who are coming into the portal will actually see only version 2.0, not the previous version. But whoever who has already subscribed to the version 1.0 will continue to use it, and they can be given enough or adequate notice to move out of that particular version to the new one before the old version is completely stopped and discontinued from the platform. Yeah, so those are the questions I have. Stefan, any other questions that we have got? There's a few other questions. There's one question on whether it can be integrated with KeyCloak. The answer is yes. KeyCloak can be integrated as a third-party key management server with the API manager. Does WS2 API manager supports Windows NTLM authentication? Again, the answer is yes. We do have a grant type for NTLM that can be used for this purpose. We have a question whether this product supports Istio. Again, the answer is yes. We provide integration with Istios. There are multiple patterns in this in how we can integrate with Istio. What we will do is we will follow up and answer you directly with the documentation on those patterns and how you can integrate with Istio. Okay, I think that answers all the questions that are available. So thanks a lot for joining the session today. I hope it was useful and you have a better understanding of how you can integrate yourself and your organization with the digital economy using a proper API management strategy. We will actually share the slide deck along with the recording of this webinar with you shortly. So thanks for joining this webinar.